Marjorie place. Now, I know that you have all signed your waivers to accept any part in which you are cast, and I hope that for you repeat offenders from the dream play of 2 years ago, that you have, if it so be your wish, managed to ascend in stage time this go around. Now, what is the credo, my little poppets?
There are
no small parts, only small actors. And
short directors.
Yes. Thank you very much for not adding the word stoked this time. Now, I am, as they say in the vernacular, working on it. Now, I expect your carriages await, as it's past this boy's bedtime already, as it were.
Can I say thank you?
You may. Just don't make it a hobby this time, yes? Remember 2 years ago when you played Peter Quince and only the man's role, you were a little careless with the line learning.
I was a scared little freshman, if you recall.
Sophomore, wasn't it?
Anyway, I will be a staunch and attentive Davenport puppet this go-round.
The term is poppet. Which, in my neck of the woods, is a term of affection.
Mm-hmm. Until off book week. Then it so subtly changes to papot, if I recall correctly.
Why aren't you taking my Shakespeare AP class this year?
Conflicted with Williker's Latin class.
Of course it did. Of course it did, yes. Professor Williker's little scheduling joke he likes to play on poor old Charles.
I don't understand.
Well, my esteemed friend and colleague, Professor Willikers, thinks that I always hoped that his first initial was G.
G?
G. G. Anyway, my friend Professor Willikers gets very perturbed that I choose to teach Titus Andronicus in my Shakespeare AP class, because he is under the mistaken impression that it contains the most amount of Latin references of any of Shakespeare's plays. Yes. He also gets upset that all the students choose to take my Shakespeare class instead of his. I heard this whole charade at the faculty picnic. So, this year, I opted to choose Julius Caesar in its stead. Which, as we in academic circles know, contains a good deal more Latin than Titus. Yes, it frustrated the hell out of him, so he switched his course to conflict with mine.
So you're upset that I, or students like me, are being screwed out of your course? Because it works both ways, Mr. Davenport. Don't you see? You're as much to blame for this petty narcissistic feud.
But it's... Yeah. Well, maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. Although, it's quite surprising, me being called a narcissist by a girl of the most narcissistic age, chronologically speaking, that God ever created.
Nope! Recently looked it up. It is ages 13 to 15, around the time of an average high school freshman. They did a study and found that that was the most narcissistic age because of the fact that narcissism is based around fear. Fear of being accepted and liked in her new environment, being still accepted by her parents who, in some cases, have coddled the hell out of her, until such time in fear of being accepted and liked or even loved by the people they fall for.
Very impressive, Miss Place. All apart from that nasty little dangling preposition at the end of your final statement.
Yes. My humble apologies.
I would go so far that you are very, to say, you're very close to cracking the human condition, or at the very least, raising the hammer to do so. In fact, to take your metaphor and that much further, Helena in Midsummer, in all her poetry and cunning, she shows great narcissism. Yes, as do the rest of all those pesky, vapid lovers that I loathe tackling every 2 years. Especially that wrestling match with the girls and then later the boys. Oh, well, I expect that old Will was just trying to lift up the mirror to those young Renaissance lovers in his audience, sighing like furnace with woeful ballads.
Made to his mistress's eyebrow. Jacques, As You Like It, Act 3, Scene 1.
Ah, yes, freshman year. I recall you looking up all those odd references even before the inevitable recitation.
I did.
Hmm.
You
actually remember that? I think my...
Yeah, carried your weight. Yes, it probably does. Yes.
Thank you again, Mr. Davenport.
You earned it, Miss Place,
as it were. Things base and vile... Folding no quantity, love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eyes, but with the mind, and therefore winged Cupid is painted blind. I knew it! I knew it! Poets speak through their muses, through their most loving and wonderful and exploding muses. This whole thing is base and vile. It's disgusting, really. It's very disgusting to have a crush on your teacher. I realize that. But Charles is a muse, not a crush. He is the interpreter of great art. He directs us, puts us in positions and poses we never thought we could manage. The lover's fight scene, right? Come on, do you think we could have done that whole backwards thing if he didn't make us try it? When I'm fake pulling Hermia's hair? What a master. And the way he moves us with such quiet passion, yet unbridled positioning, barely touching me, touching us. Choreographer of the highest degree, running circles around Miss Jane, who can hardly keep up with us during the Snow Queen debacle in the annual. Butt cracker! Fucking vile. Oh, she was pissed that Davenport didn't ask her to choreograph the fairy scene. Oh well. Sleep it off, Lady Jane. So, he and I are going over this monologue, the one that I was just doing, alone in the rehearsal room, and he puts his beautiful finger to my lips and says, "Quiet, Marjorie. You don't have to shout it. It's a secret that is yours, all yours. We'll hear it because of the passionate way you will finally emote it," he says with added elegance. "Then, Marjorie, when you are in complete understanding of Helena's wants, her intentions, her needs. Then, you can share that secret with us. What can I do? I try to think about Patrick the Tongue, to kiss him back with as much intensity as he does me. I try to keep it to my own peers. Root yourself, Marjorie. Root yourself. Stay in it. Stay in reality. Dr. Jones says, root yourself! Winged Cupid. He is painted blind. Stupid little naked little fairy fuck. What does he know, right?
Thank you.
Well, I am Charles, and I am an alcoholic. Now, I hear you asking out there, I hear you asking, how did he do it? How did I, indeed, manage 10 years of sobriety? Well, once upon a time, about 10 years ago, I was about to lose my wife and my job to this disease. I went to rehab that summer. It's what summer vacations are for us teachers, eh? Yeah? Anyway, it was a month drying out in a very nice and hospitable place in the woods, in a very atypically pleasant New England July, if I remember rightly. Anyway, I came back to my wife and my job, waiting for me to start again. Yes, and I did. And I did. Let's do it, old boy! Hey! And I did it by continually going to meetings. A good support system, a good sponsor, yes. And I read the steps as much as humanly possible, yes. Now then, higher power, Well, for me, that has always been you people, and for that I will always be eternally grateful. Yes, my inevitable dump. And for this I am eternally apologetic. Yes. I fired the marriage counsellor and then subsequently the psychologist. They just weren't making a dent in the problem. So, I'm afraid my dump has to happen. Right. Here goes the gratitude. Let's see. I have a roof over my head. I have food on the table. I have a fine institution for which I enjoy working. I have a reasonable car. And I have a nice little savings account so that I can pop over the pond once a year to see the all-important relatives. Yes, the promises in the big book came true. They did. They did. But the problem is that the house in which I live has a master bedroom that I'm not allowed into. And the house itself, it's inhabited by two ghosts. Haunted? Yes. Yes, I should say so. Yes, we both know we're there and we keep out of each other's way as much as possible. Yes, but... Sober... Yes. Love. Well, they used to be. But fighting and fighting to stay together, that's not a marriage, is it? She hated me for 10 years while I was drinking, and she puts up with me for the remaining 10, so... 20 years. 20 years of not making much sense. The problem is, that I so desperately want to get back into that bedroom. But this coin isn't going to help me. None of the last nine did either, so... So what am I to do? Hmm? Should I break it down? Hmm? Should I? Can you see? Poor old Charles D. breaking anything down? Ooh, no, 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 no. Nope. So my dump has been dumped. I hope it doesn't stink to high heaven, as it were. Well, thank you for letting me speak and presenting me with this ever-important coin. With that, I'll pass.
I think I'm going to speak. Right off the bat, I'm going to speak and not be asked the questions such as the, how does that make you feel, Marjorie, the baiting? Why do you think that was the right thing to say or do, Marjorie? The feel good patchouli scents in the office would make a girl like me feel right at home. A light enough office to see each other, my facial expressions especially, but dim enough so that I know that you empathize with my innate darkness. A small enough office for intimacy, but large enough for the perhaps eventual and unavoidable scream fest. Get it off your chest, busting through, breakthrough. Yeah, I see. Quite the observant type. Ding. So, if I'm permitted, I'm going to tell you the nutshell details of my day. That should suffice as a good beginning convo, don't you think? A Day in the Nutshell by Marjorie Place. I just got cast as Helena, a prominent part in A Midsummer Night's Dream. I later was asked out by a boy who I've been prowling for. Took a few swigs of blackberry brandy to celebrate. Pew-pew! And then tried to get through to my idiot parents that I'm not the enemy, which lasted the better part of the hour before this. The last part I am considerably fixated on. Arles not good, Dr. Jones. Arles not good. My parents are afraid of me. They walk on eggshells that I'm not even putting there, constantly checking my drawers for sociopathic contraband. She's buying purple eyeshadow now. What does that mean? She's reading Sylvia Plath and it's not part of the English curriculum. What does that all mean? She's listening to Daddy's old British folk albums and only listens to them on her headphones. There's some pretty dark songs on those albums, let me tell you. What does that all mean? Do you think it's fair to be constantly evaluated? Arms checked, notebooks checked, pupils checked, notebooks checked, phones checked, websites checked, emails checked. Yes, I know! I know this is the world. Our world currently, but when does it stop? I can stop. I can stop blaming my parents and blame where we ended up in society, but I need them to care. To create a society in my own household, at least, that isn't fearful. But then there's this All is not good, Dr. Jones. Right now, happiness and escape lies in Helena. I'm playing Helena, so I might as well live vicariously through her.
escape to the woods, play with fairies, and end up with the one I loved all along.
Well, oh, I guess that's the stuff. Right, Dr. Jones? I'm ready for your questions now.
Brown Betty, again. Whoa, whoa, Brown Betty, bambalam. Whoa, whoa, Brown Betty, bambalam. Brown Betty had a child, bambalam. That thing went blind, bambalam.
Do you live here?
Yes. Ah, Miss Place, I could say that you scared me, but you didn't. My home away from home, as it were.
You live right on campus, you don't have time
I do not have time to pop home for the obligatory pot pie and glass of port with Brown Betty waiting to be lightly nuked in the microwave. And there is a difference between living on campus and living near to campus. I am bound to the latter coordinates, so no. It is much easier for me to lunch sack it than it is to jump in my motor car and tootle off a couple of miles down the road. Yeah. So what are you still doing here?
Just finished a lab a little earlier than I expected, and I figured now it's time
Please let her say it's time for line learning.
Please let her say it's time for line learning.
No. It's time for me to grade these freshman essays, and by the looks of them, yes. The first chapter questionnaire on a separate piece. Wow. These look so gosh darn familiar!
Oh, gee willikers! Miss Place, you got me! And if you look in that filing cabinet over there, you'll find the rest of the dusty documents that I recycle every 2 years for all you poppies who come through the double doors of Davenport Hall.
Could I please commandeer one of your liver blood red macos to mac up this purpose? I will be so neat. And I know your handwriting and all the comments.
Oh, yes. All the comments that can be plucked out of this old boy's pate, eh? You know me that well, do you?
4 years, Mr. Davenport.
Oh, not quite.
Yes, quite. Summer's two in the music hall where you cast me in everything. I know your comments by heart, believe me. Now, can I just do this one little class? It's only 12 little poppets.
Yes, a veritable last supper, that lot. Those 12 little apostles will have my hair falling out completely by the end of the semester.
Ah, here we go. Ooh, Becky Guthrie, freshwoman extraordinaire, got the rest of the boy toys uproaring, swooning in their jeans every single time she shakes her golden locks out of her bovine face. Moo.
No, no, no. If you are going to make remarks, you are not going to be able to make marks on the little poppet's erudite offerings.
That's right. Good old Miss Guthrie is playing Titania. I remember you had the rest of the contending jeune fille nails out when you called out her part at the casting. I thought they would take out your voodoo dolly and start stabbing!
Just throwing bones, Miss Play, just throwing bones. There's not a lot for Titania to do anywhere, apart from get pissed at her husband and fawn over an arse and then wake up and make up with her aforementioned husband. Could be any woman in this term.
Yeah, all she has to do is study her mother.
Not fair, Miss Place. Not fair. It's the name game.
Now you're talking. Oh, me first.
I just went through the Davin portal.
Oh, right. Davin porting about.
Davin, proportionally speaking.
Are you Davin portending me?
In small Davin portions only.
Then you must meet me in the Davenport Authority.
With an old Davenport motto.
Yes. In Davenportsmouth.
Eating... Davin pork and beans. Yes, you little hairy British imp, you won fair and square.
Oh, my word. weren't we talking about narcissism just the other day? Eh? Doesn't this name game just take the cake?
But it's such a great name. Such a great name for such a great lineage.
Your eyes have been looking differently these days.
What do you mean? Don't be such a creep.
No, I didn't mean anything like that. No. It's one of Mrs. Davenport's favourite sayings. When her husband had a little too much wine on a random Saturday night. Your eyes are looking differently. That's what she used to say.
Used to?
Yes, I'm so... I don't drink wine anymore, so no more wrong-looking eyes.
What's wrong with my eyes?
Well, nothing. Nothing at all. I just thought maybe they got irritated when you were laughing a bit too much just now. That's all.
I always hated that about my eyes, the way they crinkle when I'm caught in hysterical moments in a picture or video.
Well, that can be quite charming.
Perhaps.
Did I ever tell you the story of when I was in Florida, taking my master's in cloning, of all things?
Oh, Jesus.
Yes, yes. Well, the class was given by a master from the local clone college. Now, the most interesting thing was that he had us do this one exercise. It's more like a science experiment than anything else, where we had to learn, actually memorise, all the muscles in the human face that are used in emotions. Yes. This one day, we just stood in front of our mirrors, studying our faces and trying to identify all the muscles on a little schematic that was laid out for it. It was very narcissistic. and anyway, if Marjorie and her cohort could have seen poor old Charles making these faces... She would have thought him a stroke victim. Anyway, what I valued most was that this clown master said that he could rate each one of his students' performance success on which muscles they could tap into on a regular basis. He said it was quite amazing how well they did and how well he could predict it when they came back to visit.
So you're saying that having odd facial expressions is...
Yeah, it's good for all you aspiring thespians, yes.
Well, I wouldn't know. I don't watch the production videos.
Well, you should. You see what I mean.
Well, just finished one. Becky got a perfect score.
Oh, well, that's a relief, isn't it? I shall write the requisite comments on the top. I don't seem to be trusting that you have my handwriting down that well.
I have to make a phone call. I'll see you in a little while in rehearsal.
Right. Oh, Miss Place.
Hair director.
What have you got B period tomorrow?
Study hall.
Right, if I write you out a pass, do you think we could go over the old Spite O' Hell monologue? I think it needs a little work.
Absolutely.
Right, and I think we can probably get a lot more done if we're not disturbed by the other little poppets, eh?
Your classroom?
No, we'll have to use the rehearsal space. Willikers has got my classroom this week. His is having its locks changed again.
No problem.
Yeah, and memorized this time, as it were.
As it will be.
Dreaded Hell Week is upon us once again, and since children have, since time immemorial, loved the cramming aspect of school so much, it just has to enter the hallowed walls of the latest poor Mr. Davenport's production. Oh, that's how I learned my times table. That's how I learned the Battle of Hastings. That's how I learned the theory of pi, etc., etc. Laughter? Laughter? Yes. No. No. That is not allowed, not at this stage of the game. Misplace? Tittering? Hey? No. Now that is funny. That is hilarious! Yes! Because you are single-handedly bringing this production to its knees. Oh, I bet there were some giggles at the fall of the Roman Empire or the sinking of the Titanic,
eh? Are you saying, my dear Mr. Davenport, that we are as colossal a failure as the sinking of the Titanic and the fall of the Roman Empire, all wrapped up in one big fat mess?
I am, Miss Place. And what is more, you would have been the hammer that reduced that empire to dust. You would have been the iceberg that sank that fantastic ship. Now, learn the lines, learn the blocking, practice the nuances of which I taught, or I will, as I inevitably say this time every year, cancel this production faster than you can say the bloody bard of bloody Avon! That is all. What is it, this place? Late ride again, eh? Will we yet again be waiting for the second ship custodian? Will we yet again be waiting for Lord and Lady Place's carriage to pick you up before you turn to rags and the Lexus turns to a plump pumpkin?
My father, in the VW Bug, is patiently waiting outside.
Then let's not keep the old boy waiting, eh?
What happened, Mr. Davenport?
What happened to what, Miss Place?
What just happened?
What just happened? Well, I suppose I called you out. I took you down from that highest horse that your father could purchase for you, and I placed you gently down upon the earth, a common ground, where people are responsible for other people, especially in a group project.
Please, all the rest of the third-rate theoretical thespians are not ready to put on this...
No. No, but they will be if the leading lady just
leading
gets...
Leading what? What? What happened to no small parts, only small actors?
That's for the freshman, you know that. And it's another notch on the no child left behind bedpost that we teachers like to look at the end of a weary academic day. You will not be the leading lady, the part you clamoured for, the part you beat all the Desjardin fees out and have the nails out to scratch your eyes out, hey?
You said it was no contest. Every single time I had a session on my monologues, you said I made you so happy about your decision that you couldn't stomach directing this play for the seventh time in your career. But my performance, my rendition of Helena, it turned out to be so well worth it, didn't it?
It was all true. It was all true.
Then what the hell, man?
Miss Place, at this stage of the game, you are doing horribly badly. I hope you don't ruin it for everybody else involved, and I hope you play the part with talent. The talent of which I thought you capable when you were first cast in the role. Now, you carried your weight.
Thank you, Mr. Davenport. I hope you are not too disappointed with the outcome of this difficult situation which has caused a rift between us. As it fucking were. All is not good, pal. All is not good. Bones? You're chewing on bones? You have a bucket with the bones you have discarded. A bucket. Where the hell do we have buckets of chicken in our area? This is not a bucket chicken town with bucket chicken sheeple herding into bucket chicken warehouses. This is a respectable, upper-middle-class town with culture and beautiful day schools and ballet recitals whereby we can leave our little sheeple while we have affairs in the dark corners of our country Victorian dwellings. It's a good thing. So you, my friend, must have found yourself in your stupid brother's drug-running car this evening on the other side of the tracks. Beep fucking beep. Fat, fat, fat. And no pounds gained. Yeah, I know. High metabolism, bitch. And you get to have this bucket chicken treat because you left the rehearsal debacle tonight before I got called out on the fucking carpet by our dear, sweet director. I forgot the monologue of Spido Hell. Yeah, I know, the most popular damn monologue in the damn show when I froze. And Davenport's words? I single-handedly brought the production to its knees. Oh. Spite, oh, fight, 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 fight. Rome has fell. Iceberg swell. Little fairy fuck spell. Take your juice and cut him loose and swing his neck from a creepy man's noose. In the name of action. In the name of action. That's it, pal. That's it. Guess whose wounds I'm licking, Charles Davenport? Guess whose? My own little Marjorie's wound, more of a laceration, not a mere flesh wound, a laceration, Mr. Davenport. How many times have we met in secret? In that little rehearsal room, the little window only large enough from a quick peek from a nosy freshman or curious administrator, shut up! He was setting me up. He was setting me up to be lacerated by him damning me in front of my peers. I know where you went wrong, little man. I know where he went wrong. And I will capitalize. Oh, spite. Oh, hell. He hurt, and I fell. Oh, spite. Oh, hell. I hurt, and he fell. There's a fucking chicken bone out of the bucket. Fix it! Thank you.
Dear esteemed faculty and administration, I feel it is my duty to inform you of inappropriate behavior administered by your employee, Mr. Charles Davenport. In one of his one-on-one conferences that he said were mandatory in order to keep my role in his recent production of A Midsummer Night's Dream, he would make sexual advances, both physical and verbal. I denied these advances continually. After three of these one-on-one sessions, I decided to complain to the board in order for the harassment to cease. I have specific incriminating statements in a file with our lawyer who can distribute them if you feel it necessary. Thank you, and I hope this will be resolved in due haste.
Thank you for bringing this unfortunate situation to my attention. I opt to claim no defense, give no testimony, and plead no contest. I accept your settlement offer and, as requested, tender my resignation with immediate effect. Thank you.
Would you stop with the fucking fruit pies? That's all we got, right, little freak? God, you don't gain anything from him apart from my disrespect, right? Did you have your brother's neon? Did you park it on Elm? I hope you parked it on Elm because I told you to park it on Elm. So that my parents don't see your stupid brother's drug-running car in front of their newly painted picket fence. They'd take a sledgehammer to it if they saw it out there. I did it. I did it, pal. I took initiative, he pleaded no contest, and look what happened. And his wife, Leslie, they quoted her in the Gazette. No comment. Isn't that the bomb, pal? He's wrecked! Wreckage! Is that everything? The note! The freaking note! No. No, I'm not going to leave it. As far as I gotta be, there's gotta be a library in Jersey City, right, pal? So I'll email it to my parents, explaining the whole thing, just the facts. He really, 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 really creeped me out, right? I don't deserve a creepy teacher. I don't deserve a creepy director, right? In this day and age? Next thing I know, I'll be put into a hefty bag and thrown into the back of his Saturn. Wreckage. Creepy, right, pal? Right? I have to get out of here.
So, it's the hefty bags again, eh? Right. What did, is it something I said? Or something I did? Hmm? Oh, that's it, isn't it? Something I didn't do. Yes. Well, even though I didn't do anything harmful to Miss Place, doesn't mean that she doesn't trust me. Hmm? Yes? How would it be to have a student not trust you? To be, as they say, creeped out by you? Hmm? Yes, it's hardly a wholesome atmosphere in which to teach or to be taught, is it? No. No. Well, that's the, that's the opinion of the head of school and his torch-wielding cabinet. Yes. No one cheering the old boy on, you see. We don't know what he did, but he must have done something. He must have. Yes, that would be the never-ending dirge that you would hear, like it's been sung at a never-ending funeral. Apart from by my dear wife, of course, who, when asked by the local rag about her husband of the last 20 years and this whole unfortunate affair, responded with a quick, "No comment." No comment. Oh, which is, that's so incredibly silly, isn't it, eh, Leslie? Because our whole life has been bloody chock full of your comments. Comments at breakfast, and comments at parties, and comments at events, and comments to marriage counsellors. All comments about your absolute disgust for me and my roving eye. And that provocative Lindsay Lohan DVD that I picked up because it happened to get a good review. Hmm? Was she naked? Yes, for quite a bit of it. But there wasn't quite enough gratuitous smut to persuade this inadequate, hairy British dwarf of a man to go trolling for teen tripe on the sly, don't you think? Hmm? Anyway, hefty bags. Hmm. Is it some kind of a symbol? Is it that I am an instant vagabond looking for a bridge to nest under? Yes, we do have actual luggage, you know. Yes, oh yes, of course, you need it for the Asian Symposium. How silly of me to forget. Yes, ah, dear. Never mind, never mind. Jeffrey will help me with them. Jeffrey. He's a mate, isn't he, good old Jeffrey? Yes. Yes, he says he's an avid cribbage player. And that we can have a few games when I've finished the grounds for the day. Yes. It'll make for a nice evening, yes. After the obligatory TV dinner, freshly microwaved from... Where's the shred? Where is the shred? Hmm? The shred, Leslie, you know, the shred of decency? That would mean you wouldn't call your lawyer in the morning, that you wouldn't sell the house and sell everything in it. Everything apart from my books. You can't sell those. I've had some of those books since Oxford. Oxford, you remember Oxford? Yeah? Where we met? Where we shared that one little bed? That one shabby little bed looking out over the quad? Yeah? In that one room, where we were one couple with one future? Hmm? Oh. Jeffrey's here, dear. No. I'll get my bags. I'll handle my baggage. I always have.
They have the best pancakes here. Choco Nana cakes are the bomb! Chocolate, bananas, well, and pancake batter. But they also have this kick-ass assortment of syrups. I mean, what other diner in Jersey City does this, huh? A huge assortment of syrups. But I mean, this isn't a chain. They don't need to provide this. The people that patronize this place don't need it. And they're free. Like when you buy the pancakes, they bring this huge assortment out to you and you don't have to pay extra. Yeah, I know that sugar and salt and cream and pepper are free, but syrups? Oh, the choco. Yeah, thank you. I bet they take a bath on those little gems. I bet they do. You know, my parents used to take me. But my parents don't matter anymore. They don't matter anymore. Not really. Not anymore. Anyway, my parents used to take me to a place for breakfast after church. And you actually had to frickin' pay for the extra syrup. I mean, pay for it. But the jellies were free. They threw them at your table like confetti at a wedding. It was their charity. Jellies. Jellies suck. Syrups, where it's at. That's where I saw him again. Where my parents used to take me. I didn't tell you about that, did I? I ruined his life, right? But I guess that doesn't matter. He doesn't matter. Let it pass, Marjorie, you stupid little girl. You're scarfing up those fries like nobody's business. Is it trick time tonight? Not for me, pal. I have another shot at the pharmacy, and I'm not doing that kid in a candy store crap again. Well, because I can't. I actually can't. They're so cracked down on counting their stash, it's pathetic. You think they'd miss one? So go ahead, fire me! But I come back from this rehab that I made up with this awesome lineage and kick-ass family rep, and I'm back on the workforce. Like magic. Because I don't know that crappy life anymore. Big-ass pills I can't even swallow. Have to snort them. I'm done with that. Like I'm done with my parents and Mr. Davenport and... The past is past. You know, I always used to like that. Past, spelled P-A-S-T, is past. P-A-S-S-E-D. Where are my parents? Huh, pal? Is it so hard to find me? Stop fucking eating and give me something! Whore. Yeah. Whore. I
my job back, pal. I got my job. Thanks. And Choco Nana Cakes.
Say you scared me, but that would be almost true. So, what have you got for me then? Did you bring your lawyer with you? Which one of these fine litigators zooming around Grand Central is going to cast down an incriminating document next to my tasty croissant, eh? Or maybe it will be a swarm of litigators. Yes! Maybe that will be it. Reminiscent of the O.J. Simpson army of defenders. Yes, yes. well, there's narcissism for you, isn't it, eh? The swarming of poor old Charles Davenport. No, I don't think I'm going to be swarmed. So, what is it, Miss Place? What have you got for me this
time? Would you stop with the fucking monologues? I'm not up for that in this moment in time.
Well, yes. Yes, well, I suppose that is the primary medium I've chosen to express myself in these days. The never-ending monologue. Yes, it's like I'm being scripted by some maniac who can't even write a decent...
There you go again. Jesus Christ. I'm not getting up, and there's nowhere else to sit, as you can see. So let's try a little we're not obligated to have to talk time, shall we?
No, it's not going to happen the way that you want it. The way that you want it to.
Don't want anything.
No. I don't suppose you do want anything. I don't suppose you want anything at all after your time in the sun. So what are you doing here? Oh, is it back home on that lonely old 7:13 a.m. train? I heard you were missing, as they say.
Fuck me, missing. That's hilarious. I'm alive, aren't I? Missing means milk carton death in my book. It's so easy to find me. It's so easy to find anyone these days.
Absolutely. So, Lord and Lady Place didn't come to collect you from wherever you were? Oh, is that it? So, the The runaway, the scene fleeing, it didn't quite catch fire, eh? Hmm? Oh! Where's that poor girl that Davenport ruined? Oh! Is he keeping her in hiding? Or are they doing the star-crossed lover thing after all? Oh! Has she turned to the dark side? With needle in arm, an occasional trick.
What?
What,
you little weasel? The occasional trick? Who do you think I am? Who do you think this girl is that you screwed over?
Screwed
over. I never said we had sex, Mr. Davenport. I never said anything of the kind.
You might as well have.
Well, I didn't. I'm actually repulsed by you. And I don't think we should be talking about this, even though it's dead and buried.
Dead and buried? Oh, that's rich, that is. Though, even though it would be against principle, but as you say, it is dead and buried, after all. I am courageously inviting you to come and visit me in the bookshop that I manage. I don't own it. No, not anymore. That was far too grand a plan for this broken-down British middle-aged dwarf. No. I want you to come and see where I'm dead and buried, as it were. If you... Even if I don't know you are there, even if you only look upon it from afar, I want you to come and pay your respects. There. The address is on the card. It shan't be hard to find. I do hope you will come and pay your respects. You'll catch the 7:13 a.m. if you hurry. I'm not going that way. I'm going in quite the opposite way, as it were. I did write something on the back of that card. It's the name of that book by Nabokov. A mother was washing her baby one night, was the youngest of 10 and a delicate mite. Her mother turned round for the soap off the rack. 'Twas only a moment, but when she turned back, hello, Lolita. I could say that you scared me, but I'm too drunk to be fucking scared.
You're supposed to be closed. The hours say 10 to 6, and it's 6:30 now.
My dear Miss Place, we have been closed for some time now. Yes, I thought about chaining myself to the door in protestation until I was turning this place into a donut shop, but I decided I would just sit here all day, all night if necessary, until they come and they take me and they put me in a cab and send me somewhere. Yes, I mean, that would be the polite thing to do, wouldn't it, rather than just leaving me by the sidewalk? Hey, Lolita?
I would like for you to not call me that.
Of course you wouldn't, of course you
wouldn't. Because I just read it. I vomited several times when I got to the last page. And I didn't reach the toilet.
I know how that feels.
And I didn't leave it to the housekeeper,
so... Oh, you didn't? You didn't? Oh, that's a shame. That is. What's her name then, hey? Is it Jemima? or is she someone you call a housekeeper who brought you up? Like a lovely cuddly nanny, like that dog in Peter Pan. Or is she someone that Lord and Lady Place gave her in her lineage a post-Civil War job to make up for all the hard fucking times, eh? Did you clear it up yourselves then? Hmm? Eh? Oh, that was a shame. Oh. Firewater? You can finish it if you like. I'm sure your spry little teen leg will make it to the bathroom on time.
I'm almost 20, Mr. Davenport.
Oh, well, yes. Well, I'd never asked your age, did I? But then again, I refused counsel, so there you go. So, if I had just waited a week or two to put my finger to your lips with those directorial words of wisdom, then it wouldn't have been...
The trial of the century, as you see, with so much wasted hyperbole.
Don't do that! Don't you fucking dare do that, you fucking little minx! Don't you use words that you would not normally use! That's me you're mimicking or emulating or whatever the fucking term would be. Hmm? Yes, I'm the one with the grand turn of phrase, not you. Not you, my low-down, lascivious Lolita. Hmm? I gotcha. Gotcha. With a grand flourish of alliteration. Hmm? Hey! Oh, you didn't see that one coming, did you, eh, Lolita? Ah. Oh, well, you probably did. You know me so well, don't you?
You gave me your card.
I gave you my card, yes. I gave you my card, and I remember what I said when I gave it to you. I said it was for you to come and see where I was dead and buried, as it were. Yes, I still had it then, didn't I? Eh? At our meeting in Grand Central. Yeah, I still had it. The shitty little comment. The I've got the last word little caustic remark. I was feeling quite remarkably happy that day, and I was feeling happy because I was on my way to meet a very kind and very loving and a very nice lady from New Haven. Yes. I met her on a chat room, you know, a very safe chat room that I frequented.
That's promising.
Promising? Promising. Yeah, promising, that's the word, promises. A promise made to poor old Charles. She ditched me. Mm. I don't know where she was. She wouldn't pick up the phone. She never said exactly where she lived. I think I was in just about the right area, but then there were the dizzy spells and the blackouts and not from the old wine sack. No. It was a brain tumour, inoperable. So what with that and the subsequent decision to give up the bookstore, it's not mine anymore, of course, but it's being sold. Yes, well, it's all about giving up at the moment, isn't it, Lolita?
Oh, I'm so... Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh. You're sorry? Oh, well, at least I've got an apology.
What can I do, Mr. Davenport?
What can you do about what, Lolita?
Well, for you,
for me, or for your parents, or for the school you fucked over with a less than savoury reputation, or the friends that abandoned you, or the lawyers you bamboozled, or just for little old me. Hmm?
I don't know how to repent.
Well,
I don't know what it is to repent. I'm too young to even dive in that far. I'm not religious. I wasn't even baptized. My parents were Unitarian.
Ooh, the worship of the potluck supper!
Exactly. So, when I say I don't know how to repent, I mean, I can't do something I don't know how to do. I can't fake it. It's foreign. I read about flagellation. I think I
at least suffered on the streets there for some time in a Buddhistic way.
Well, at least you got
well,
to
let
go.
Let me finish.
As you wish, Miss Place, as you wish.
Punishing myself. It's not getting me anywhere. Where is it getting me?
Well, at least I'm enjoying myself.
Yeah, you are. And all those screwed over people you mentioned, they get off on it every day. So enjoyment ensues. That's just great. I'm the clown. The town jester that's good for a sideshow entertainment. Never thought she'd do this, they say. Lord and Lady Place didn't see it coming. What a conscientious student. Why would she make up such crap and ruin a guy's life?
You know, they could not be thinking about you at all.
Narcissist.
Yes. But let's get back to that question that you posed. Why would she make up such crap and ruin a guy's life? It's a good question. Why don't you answer it?
Because you hurt me.
Ah, yes. And the ripple effect?
What?
The ripple effect. You've never heard of that?
No.
Ah, well, I've been going to a few AA meetings. Do me the world of good, wouldn't you say? And they talk about the ripple effect. As in, you take a stone and you throw it into a stagnant pool of water. The pool could be a small one or a rather large one. Mine would be a fairly small one. And the stone itself could be large or small. The smaller ones, they can be dealt with the art of spinning the story. But your stone, Marjorie's rather large, a la Sisyphus stone, that caused all those ripples to happen. And as for me, as for poor old Charles, well, I rippled quite frequently from Marjorie's stone, didn't I? Yes. Repent the ripples, dear girl. That's the rub.
I'm sorry, Mr. Davenport, but my apology is all I got.
I don't think your apology is all you got. Not even close, Lolita. Oh, your baby has gone down the plug hole. Your baby has gone down the plug. The poor little thing was so skinny and thin. He should have been washed in a jug. A jug. He should have been washed in a jug. Your baby is perfectly happy. He won't need a bath anymore. He's mucking about with the angels above. Not lost, but gone before. Good God, girl. I didn't mean this. I meant a living amends. So what is this now, eh? More shite on the old boy's conscience, eh? And yes, it is about me. It's about me and all those others that you rippled by. And the crowds have all gone now. I watched from the bushes over there. And I wasn't alone, actually. Do you remember that stage manager from Midsummer? What's her name? Well, she was there. She just stood there eating fruit pies. Well, I suppose I can say what I want to say now, since you're...
Since you can't get away without vomiting up yet another monologue?
Misplaced. Could say that you scared me, but that would be...
Really true?
Really true, yes. Mr. Davenport has had blackouts and the raging DTs before, but never a visit from the netherworld.
This is a nice plant. You were actually sober enough to think this one through? Or did the store make the suggestion?
Of course it was the store. Look who you're dealing with. Touching is allowed now, is it? Hey? Did you bring your attorney with you this time? Is he hiding behind one of the more expensive monuments, eh?
Forgiveness is still too difficult, isn't it, Mr. Davenport?
Well, what's it going to do, really, Is it going to bring you back from purgatory or limbo or whatever dastardly place they're holding you? No. My forgiveness is hardly going to breathe the breath of life into your recently interred body, is it?
God, you're annoying. Can't you say anything without a turn of phrase or qualification? Even at a pivotal time when you're able to talk to the dead.
No, I don't think that's possible.
It isn't, is it?
No. I can't say it is. As it were.
As it were.
As it bloody is.
My parents were genuinely weeping during the eulogy.
Yes, they were. And they weren't the only ones.
Do you know I was adopted?
No, I didn't.
Found out from my social worker that they were both sterile. What are the odds, eh? Both parents are, shall we say, partners now, sterile.
Well, that is a bit unusual.
I mean, I'm sure it happens. And they still have great careers that will inevitably end up in the corner office of their respective companies. So they bought me. Cha-ching. Surrogacy. Big money in that, I hear. Those knocked-up single mamas don't fool around. I mean, don't get me wrong, I felt a lot of love in my formative years, as they were meant to be my parents, my only parents. And I never met the biological mommy. Did never want to. Although she did provide a good addition to the human race, if I do say so myself.
Yes, she did.
I heard something on the radio before this happened. They were interviewing some chick on where learning begins. The fetus, of course, even I knew that. Biology grades finally improved. Furthermore, the fetus can hear and can learn through their experience in the womb what is fearful, wonderful, challenging, nurturing, etc., etc., to the mother from the mother's voice. Her voice in general is the key. I assume that everyone born gets to hear that voice and instantly recognize it. Last week, my mother was telling a story at a party my parents were giving, and it was dull and innocuous as per usual. But this time, I closed my eyes, and I put my ear to the open door and tried desperately to recognize the sound, the timbre, the use of inflections and nuances in Miss Charlotte Place's voice, and it didn't strike a chord. I realized I never had that experience. So I got out the secret stash from the dollhouse. A great hiding spot, by the way.
and crushed those pills in anger. More anger than ever before. It was strong and palpable. It was a kick-ass anger, let me tell you, sir. Gave King Lear a reason to pause. Smashing and crushing those pills into fine bits and powder. I did it ever so quietly, though, still listening, so that I could catch some familiarity, get soothed, trying to place in memories my mother's fucking voice! It didn't. I couldn't. So I snorted the crushed white mess nice and hard. Eyes went to heaven. Breath left me. Heart stopped. Greatest escape I ever felt.
But you always said that you hated suicide. I remember you saying that you thought the to be or not to be speech was a load of old crap and that the great danger just do something.
I still think that!
Then why? Ah. You didn't mean to, did you? That wasn't quite the effect you were going for, was it?
No. I just wanted a night of escape. All those times on the streets, you know. I had gotten my acceptance letter from Wesleyan and they said I could enroll next semester. I told my parents and they were psyched. Hugged me lovingly and seemed genuinely happy that I finally managed to come back.
Oh, Miss Place. That's the biggest tragedy of all, I guess. That's the tragedy that hits home hardest.
More than Hamlet, huh? And what's hysterical is that everyone I've come in contact with, at least the ones in the eulogy, were convinced, fucking convinced that it was suicide, and I guess nobody writes notes anymore. I mean, even Kurt Cobain managed to write a few sentences before offing himself. And I'm a good writer, that much I know.
I was one of those people.
Do you remember when you told me about the ripple effect? It doesn't end, does it? One of those eternal screw jobs we all get to enjoy, even us dead people.
Yes. Yes, we all just go rippling. There's nothing to stop us. But I'm sorry to say, I'm genuinely sorry to say.
I know. I'm not forgiven.
It's just not in me, I'm afraid.
Even when I haunt you? Christ, man, I don't get a break, do I?
Something tells me that this is the end. This is it. The end of the haunting, the last of our visitations, as it were.
Yeah, that's what they tell me. Hopefully I'll slip into your subconscious and give you a few guilt dreams!
I would much rather you did-
Brain tumor? Really?
Nope. I lied about that.
Good one. Oh, and I
hope you saved your 10-year sobriety coin.
How do you know about that?
You're going to need it!
But I've no idea where it was. I don't know what's happened to it. I don't know. I don't even know what I was wearing that day. But... Ah! Oh, yes, Miss Marjorie! Miss Marjorie, it's here! Look, I've got it! It's a bottle cap. How bloody ironic. Well, onwards and upwards, Charles. Onwards and upwards! Well, maybe I'll find that coin. Where could it be? Maybe it's with my baggage! Yes! Or maybe it's with the shred. Who knows? Oh.